First, QED discovers it's not easy being a dolphin.
But he might be about a foot short of the first down. Howie Long on the bottom of the pile.
What's that, Howie Long, huh? He's a man, isn't he?
January 1984. American football fans are glued to their TV sets as the Los Angeles Raiders take on the Washington Redskins. In the commercial break, Apple computers pay over $1 million for 60 seconds of America's attention. Their ad, a version of George Orwell's 1984, costs more per second than a Hollywood feature film, but it seems to work. Sales of Apple computers rocket. The new generation of ads may be expensive and look weird, but if they work, perhaps it's because they appeal to our innermost needs and aspirations.
It's not easy being a dolphin.
It's a long way from the early days of television advertising.
It's tingling fresh. It's fresh as ice. It's Gibbs SR toothpaste. The tingling fresh toothpaste that does your gums good too.
To sell SR, the message was simple, and the psychology obvious.
It's much more than a nice taste. It's a tingle of health. It tells you something very important, that you're doing your gums good and toughening them to resist infection.
So get your stripes, it's the fun way to brush your teeth and fight decay.
Signals first, pain your teeth.
Today, Gibbs has to work to make sure it's the brand you pick up off the shelf. The new ads play on image and emotion. What is in your mind when you pick up a jar of coffee?
Hello. Look, I'm sorry to bother you, but I'm having a dinner party and I've run out of coffee.
Come in.
Thank you.
What makes you pick up one brand of soap powder rather than another?
Oh, Mom!
With such a huge variety of choice, knowing the way to get the consumer to buy your brand is vital. Get it wrong, and you could face obscurity. All of these products have now disappeared off our shelves. But Guinness have been one of the lucky ones. They've been successfully advertising since the 1920s. One reason for that success is that they've kept up with modern research techniques, like those offered by psychologist Peter Cooper. He wants to uncover our deepest feelings about products like chocolates.
I'd like you to quickly go through the magazines and cut out any pictures that strike you as sort of reminding you of what box chocolates stand for. We're trying to understand how people feel about brands, how they relate to brands, that is to say, what the brand's personality is as far as consumers are concerned. And there are a number of techniques which are very, very helpful for getting to that understanding.
What about the different senses?
Peter Cooper's willing victims are ordinary members of the public who allow him to delve into their unconscious.
Different brands of chocolates have different meanings for people. They signify different types of gift-giving situation. Now, from an advertiser's point of view, gift-giving is all about sending messages to people, and what the advertising needs to do is to fit the message to the product and the product to the message.
There's an awful lot of dressing up on chocolates. They always look... some of them look better and what's inside the product sort of thing. The actual camouflage.
Tell us a bit more about that. Which picture are you particularly thinking of?
The lady in the underwear.
Her?
You see, yeah.
Right.
You know, that's a lot what comes out of adverts is that's what's on the inside of chocolates. That's what it looks like underneath the wrappings. But a lot of it is dressing.
And you always had the starlet laying in bed on silk sheets in her underwear eating chocolates. Bob Geldof said the same about Paula Yates, who used to lay in bed surrounded with magazines and chocolates like a 50s starlet.
Uh-huh. So if you were describing a woman who somehow to you had that character, what sort of person is it?
A sultry woman. Very mm-hmm. sultry. Mystical.
Yes?
45-year-old.
Right.
Sophisticated 45-year-old.
So, all gold here becomes a person. What sort of person does it become in your mind's eye?
Classy. Sophisticated. Mm-hmm. 20s to early 30s.
Mm-hmm.
Yuppie-ish.
Mm-hmm.
Likes the good things in life.
Where does all this feeling coming from?
The gold.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing what's inside. The wrapping isn't deceiving.
Imagine another person. Where does Dairy Box fit
in? A
nanny.
Yes,
it's definitely old.
Yes.
You mean you've got grandmother on the top? Is that what you mean? Mm. Or perhaps I'm pushing it a bit.
I don't know, it is a very young grandmother.
Yeah, right. Now, the way in which the manufacturers use this material is it gives them knowledge about the meanings that people want to see in the advertising. And by meanings, I mean the tone of voice, the way it all comes over to you, and also the stories that are involved in the advertising, the way in which the brand expresses itself.
Cooper moves from chocolates to painkillers and onto an unusual method called role play.
So I'm asking you to imagine a stage, a piece of theatre, right? And one person is going to be the sufferer. Right? Who's really suffering. Then I need another person to be the pain.
So Jean becomes the sufferer and John is the pain. As John attacks her, Jean, not surprisingly, develops a headache. This is shown by the face mask with tears on it. Then the painkillers enter and deal with John, the pain.
Now in role-playing, the individual becomes the product, actually expresses the personality of the product as they see it. They then act that out in terms of how they feel the product would behave.
Compare this to the action of the second painkiller. This may look bizarre, but some advertisers spend millions on this sort of research.
Now, it is evident that there are two quite distinctive modes of action, one which is aggressive, assertive, that tries to fight the pain away, and yet another mode of action which is about calming, soothing, where the painkiller becomes almost like a tonic. Now these two positions represent a way of segmenting one's brand from another brand, giving it quite a different personality. Which brand is most like brand A? If you had to think of a brand on the market at the moment, what would it be?
Boots or Aspro or Disprin, anything like that. Attacks the pain.
That would be brand A?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Brand B, I don't know. Is there anything on the market that would soothe away the pain like that does,
mm-hmm.
as they described it there?
Mm-hmm. Now, often we are asked to get to the really basic roots of a brand, what it stands for in people's emotions. And clay modelling is a very helpful device for doing so. There are no words involved. No pictures. And the way that people are typically asked to do this, they're given a piece of clay and shut their eyes, feel about the brand, the product, whatever it may be, and let their fingers shape it, shape their relationship with the brand, shape what it stands for in their lives. But just roll it in your hand, get your hands used to it, getting it moving and so forth. What I'm going to ask you to do is to turn this piece of clay into a shape corresponding to the way in which you feel about the Labour Party. When we look at the Labour Party images, we see symbols of broken promises. We see symbols with holes in them. Something has broken, something has disappeared. And therefore, the need is to bring back conviction and commitment. To make the completion of the promise, it is to complete the circle, to complete the ring. Okay, now when you're through and feel that's okay, that's how the Labour Party feels, pick up the other piece of clay and now make a shape, a feeling, which is all about how the Conservative Party feels to you personally. Right? Nobody's going to ask you to justify this, just as it feels to you inside yourself, the Conservative Party. In the case of the Conservative Party, the images are two-dimensional, rather ugly. In fact, it is evident that what people are looking for from the Conservative Party are stronger images of comfort and security and love. These techniques have been used by advertisers in a number of ways. They've been used in fields as diverse as washing products through to cars. They've been used in development of politics and political approaches, as well as in ordinary toiletries.
To uncover the personality of Guinness, Peter Cooper turned to psychodrawing.
The consumer is given crayons, paper, and asked to doodle, to express their feelings, to go inside their own head, pull out their feelings, and somehow get them onto paper without words. When we were asked to work on Guinness and what that meant to people, psychodrawings were a particularly helpful approach. Here are some examples. What they demonstrated, and these are ordinary drinkers expressing their feelings about drinking Guinness, were such things as these. Here you see a rich, very female aspect of Guinness, nourishing, something that takes you in. It's warm outside, black inside. Another example, almost Celtic and elemental in its character. Here we see wheat and barley, growth, the seasons. And they come alive, but they've got almost a burning quality. The thing is alive, it's on fire, it does things to you. These were the so-called inner properties of Guinness.
If you think it's psychobabble, Cooper's drawings were translated into a £5 million ad campaign for Guinness. Guinness's inner Celtic personality is represented by images of wheat and the changing seasons.
All brands, and this is true of Guinness too, have an outer character as well. And you can see it partly represented in this particular picture. And here you see the individuality of Guinness, its sense of humour. The glass of Guinness becomes almost like a woman.
Using these drawings, another campaign was designed representing the ideal Guinness drinker.
Okay, babes, I'll do the business. Conjure me up one ever so blue Hawaii, one in between the sheets, and for moi, a low-slung mega-zombie with positively all the trimmings. Cherry and a stick, little umbrellas, pineapple chunks. Know what I mean?
Packet of crisps, please. I make mine a straight-talking midnight lightning black IQ brew with a smooth velvet body, cool head up top, a touch of no trimmings, no ice, no umbrella.
You what?
Pure genius.
But to take the brand into the 1990s, Guinness had to unite these inner and outer personalities into a single campaign. They had to find a way to attract new drinkers without alienating the traditional Guinness drinker. Have a look at what they came up with.
If it didn't exist, you'd have to invent it.
In terms of how the ads actually appear, we thought it quite important that they actually had a sort of cultish feel about them. So, we wrote these about a year and a half ago, I suppose, and we looked around at all the things that were happening, and there was things like The Prisoner, Stepford Wives, Max Headroom, and many other sort of images from magazines and things like that, all mixed up in there. The reason for that is that it's important that the Guinness brand is seen as a contemporary image, and of course cults is where you find individuals.
This was the secret of the new campaign. Researcher Stephen Wells had analysed the drinks market and uncovered a new trend.
We identified that there was this trend towards what might be called individualism, where people wanted to still be part of a crowd, but to express themselves as individuals within it, to have their own personalities, to be, I suppose, their own men. And this was something which was being manifested already in beer, where people seemed to want to collect lots of long-necked green foil bottles rather than a collection of empty pints. I suppose it's another manifestation of what might be called yuppie-dom. So the trick really was to identify how Guinness might exploit this trend towards individualism. It had an inherent advantage, of course, being black with a creamy head. What people are drinking is obviously Guinness. And so the advertising had to identify how this drink could become a badge for the individual. We came to the conclusion that in the end, the adoption of a strong central character was the best way of embodying the qualities of Guinness. A central character who was very much his own man, someone who would lift himself above the mundane and the humdrum to make his own choices.
I'm going to sit here. You're going to try.
The actor Rooker Hauer. To explain why he's in our Guinness commercials, I've got to go right back to the brief. When you're asked to write commercials about individualism, it raises quite an interesting philosophical teaser or problem, if you like, because by definition, an individual has a discrete set of characteristics which he doesn't share with anybody else. So, if I was to write a commercial which showed a person, his occupation, the clothes he wore, where he lived, and showed him drinking Guinness, your takeout might well be, will it suit me because I'm not that person?
Guinness solved the problem of portraying individualism by giving Rutger Hauer an unusual role.
What Rutger Hauer is actually playing, the character he is playing, is a pint of Guinness. Or rather, the sort of, the alter ego of a pint of Guinness, if you like, the personification. If Guinness was a man, that's what he would look like.
The planet Mars is paradise. Voices are never raised in argument. Never. There's only one sex, so...
No emotional problems. No fast cars. No noisy discos. Everyone is equal and lives to 803.
Rutger was even dressed in black and white to look like a pint of Guinness.
Me? I sold up and moved to Earth.
We always knew that the advertising, if it was going to be successful, would go over the heads of some people. In fact, I remember one chap saying to me, it looks as if the advertising agency had been tripping out on LSD when they made that commercial.
It's not easy being a dolphin.
The dolphin commercial is, that's one of my favorites because it's nice and simple. What it's actually saying is it's tough on dolphins because they can't drink Guinness. Why dolphins? Because dolphins are intelligent creatures. There seems to be a kind of empathy between dolphins and human beings, which is quite nice for the character because it portrays the Guinness man in a nice way because he is being sympathetic towards them.
Unlike Guinness, some companies want to sell to specific groups. One ad agency has obliged by giving the British consumer a new class structure. Market researchers used to divide us into groups according to our income. Young and Rubicam decided that what's important now is not how much we earn, but how we want to spend our money. And that depends on our innermost needs. The new system is called 4Cs. It labels us according to the basic need that motivates our behavior. QED asked Wyandor for real examples. Maureen is a mainstreamer. Nick, an aspirer. Alan, a succeeder. And Naomi, a reformer.
If the primary need is security and belonging, we call the groups mainstreamers. If it's status and the esteem of others, then it's aspirers. If it's control, it's succeeders. And if it's self-esteem, it's reformers.
By pinpointing those needs, John Banks thinks he can tell what sort of newspaper we read, what sort of goods we buy, and the television programs we watch. He can even design ads that will appeal to those needs. This ad for Legal and General was designed to appeal to mainstreamers by emphasizing their need for security. This is symbolized by the Legal and General umbrella.
If you're in the market for a personal pension, of all the companies you could talk to, we like to think we are the brightest.
Now that's the sort of ad that should make Ron and Maureen Stanger want to take out a pension with Legal and General. According to John Banks, they are typical of mainstreamers.
We both come from Sydenham, childhood sweethearts, and after having a few years in Sydenham, in a masonette, we found it wasn't large enough for us, so we moved to what turned out to be Beckenham.
The mainstreamer group is by far the largest group in the United Kingdom. It represents over 40% of the population. And because of that, it's a desperately important group to advertisers and marketeers alike.
Well, the bedroom, we chose green because it's a nice soft colour, and we both like green. The covers we bought from Marks and Spencer's, and the units from Debenhams, the little pictures we just picked up. In time, I'd like curtains and bedspreads to match, but have to wait till we get the money for that.
A mainstreamer, by and large, doesn't want to stand out from the crowd. He'll tend to buy a Ford or a General Motors because a lot of other people have them.
There's far too many foreign cars in the country. We've just come back from France, and there's not many foreign cars in France, other than French cars, of course. I'd like big stickers on my car condemning the unpatriotic people, but money talks, unfortunately.
Security is the most important thing in their lives, and because of that, when they tend to buy products, they tend to buy brands that are very well known with very famous brand names, such as Heinz.
I usually buy named brands of tins and things because I find them more satisfactory. I've tried the cheaper brands, and I don't really like them.
While the advertisers might be able to appeal to Maureen and Ron's need for security, they must take a different approach to attract the aspirer.
That's why I'm easy.
Apparently, this ad for the Halifax appeals to the aspirer's need for status and status symbols. According to John Banks, they have a great love for cash and credit cards. The ad portrays a typical aspirer. He isn't at all interested in security, just how to get hold of his money. Nick Evans is an aspirer.
This is what I'm doing at the moment. It's a self-heating can, and hopefully it'll make me £375,000 a year for the next 10 years. Besides this, I'm also importing papyrus from Egypt. These papyrus are different from all the others because it's done on the old-style paper, and they're all hand-painted. They'll sell for about £65 each framed.
Nick has just returned to London after working in Egypt for some years.
I made a lot of money over there tax-free, of course, and decided to buy myself a Rolex, had a chain made, a ring made in Egypt. I also came back, bought the flat and furnished it myself. Sony Hi-Fi, that's an export model, Lowy TV.
But they tend to go out and buy symbols and status symbols or wear badges. If you walk into their flats, they tend to have hi-fi on display, the latest magazines showing. They participate in the latest sports.
I took up karate in Egypt, basically because there was nothing else to do over there in the evenings. And I reached the standard of brown belt last year. I like the good things in life, and my aim is onwards and upwards to the top. Regarding status symbols, I do like the good things. I like my Porsche, I like my Rolex, I like my hi-fi equipment, I like my bracelet. I like the good things in life, and that's what I'm out to get.
If John Banks is right, the Halifax ad will appeal to aspirers, but have no effect on succeeders. They've already achieved status and have no need for status symbols. Alan Rowlandson is a succeeder.
Ambition, I feel, is
basically an in thing that one feels one wants to be ambitious, and therefore to be ambitious one has to give a great deal of effort to be successful. Really, this was brought about by my father, who many years ago started a small brokerage business. And to be frank, I think after three heart attacks it sort of killed him. And one felt that I would try to build something that I would be able to leave, not necessarily for my family, but for my clients and for my company and their directors.
One of the things that they say are things like being, they must be in control. We talked to some succeeders who will never fly in a commercial airline. In fact, they do. But the reason they feel nervous about it is they can't actually physically be in control of the controls of that aircraft.
Being slightly autocratic, I have to be in control of things. How I drive the car, how I sail the boat, how I run the business and the home. That if I pass that control to somebody else that I have no option over, then I find I cannot cope with that.
So, 2 years in New York, and he thinks he can tell us how to run things.
According to Banks, this ad asks the succeeder to identify with the one businessman who ultimately ends up in control.
Not first class.
Of course not. Company policy.
By the time he gets in, he'll be exhausted.
And he won't have had time to incorporate those new figures I sent him in his report.
He'll be hungry and tired.
I've arranged for the chauffeur to bring him straight here, not to the hotel.
Like a lamb to the slaughter, gentlemen.
Morning.
New Club World delivers the businessman ready to do business.
Pleasant trip.
Yes, thank you.
The reformers, in fact, are perhaps the most talked about group that we've looked at. They're often dubbed the Guardian readers or the Sainsbury shoppers. The sort of occupations that people have in this group tend to be journalists or teachers. And in fact, they're the most educated group that we looked at. Over 50% of them had some form of further education, including PhDs.
I think life, the quality of life, is more important than the quality of possessions or things that you own.
Naomi Lyons is a reformer. She lives in Surbiton with her husband and children and should be motivated by self-fulfillment. According to Banks, this shows itself in a wish to influence society.
Okay, then. Bye. Well, that was a call from the PTA committee. I'm very heavily involved in the PTA at the school because I've been having four children. It's obviously quite important in our lives.
If you go into their homes, you see a lot of pine and cork and very many natural products. They're responsible for starting many new markets, including, for example, Own Label, where their educational platform told them the benefits that Own Label had over branded goods.
As you can see, it's nearly all Sainsbury's own stuff. If I do buy all the cereals and things down there, and the tins. There are a lot of tinned tomatoes and some hoops and beans, and very little else, actually. Oh, tuna and sardines and things. Don't get up there, Dave, because you'll hurt yourself.
In appealing to the reformers' need for intellectual self-fulfillment, ads like this are successful.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Seen from another point of view, it gives quite a different impression. But it's only when you get the whole picture you can fully understand what's going on.
John Banks is naturally convinced that from an advertiser's point of view, 4Cs works.
4Cs does give us, if you like, the first point of contact with an individual. If we can understand his prime motivations, we're better able to be able to communicate with him and maybe to sell our products more effectively and efficiently in the marketplace.
The press claimed the Tories used research like this during the election to woo mainstreamers like Maureen. But don't worry if you haven't spotted yourself yet. You might be the sort of individualist Guinness is looking for.
Conventional wisdom, a sandpit for an ostrich. At the University of Life, we run a different course. Entitled, Who Am I?
Life out!
Pay attention. I may be asking questions.